أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على من بعث رحمة للعالمين، حبيبي وحبيب إله العالمين، طب القلوب ودوائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد، الله صل وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والسابقون السابقون أولئك المقربون في جنات النعيم، صدق الله العلي العظيم. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Another opportunity we are given by Allah سبحانه وتعالى to come to Friday prayer and remind one another about تقوى الله. As you know, one of the keys of Salat al-Jum'ah is taqwa. To remind one another how to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why our maraja, our fuqaha, they said on the day of Jum'ah, it is wajib upon khatib or imam that he must mention something about taqwa. He must. Even if he doesn't talk about it, he has to say taqwa. The word taqwa must be mentioned in Salat al-Jum'ah. And the reason is because Salat al-Jum'ah is a day and place we come to remind one another about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is one of the purpose of Salat al-Jum'ah. And reminding one another about taqwa Allah, hadith coming from Imam al-Muttaqin, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi, where he says, "Man ittaqa Allah, aasha qawiyyan." Where are the people who want to be powerful and strong? Where are the people who are looking to be the strong people? Now, Imam Ali tells you, the way to become strong is within the taqwa Allah. When a person has taqwa Allah, Imam Ali says, "Aasha qawiyya." He will live very strong. It doesn't matter his surrounding. As long as you have Allah, you are strong. Now, there are so many examples. One of the simple examples for all of us is Bilal al-Habashi. Bilal al-Habashi is one of the examples. Bilal was not worthy, that of money, didn't come from a known tribe, strong tribe, didn't have any position that he could claim. But Bilal, because of taqwa Allah, Bilal was very strong. That this owner who used to punish Bilal just to get Bilal al-Habashi to leave Islam. He did everything he could, putting Bilal al-Habashi without a cloth, on the sand, in the middle of desert, whipping and hitting him. But with taqwa Allah, Bilal al-Habashi continued to say, "Al-Ahad, Al-Ahad, Al-Ahad."
his master with the money, with the publicity, with everything, finally he has to let Bilal go.
Then I can, I did everything, but Bilal is still strong, so I can. He has to sell Bilal to get rid of Bilal. And the reason is taqwa Allah.
Imam Ali says, man taqwa Allah, whoever fears Allah, ashaqawiyyan,
he will live very strong.
That's not only that. He says, wasara fi biladihi, fi biladi aduwihi, amin.
And he or she will walk around in the land of his enemies very strong.
He or she will live in the land of his enemy
very peacefully in that land.
Now, if you look in the Quran, so many examples of that. One example, Ibrahim al-Khalil alayhi salam with Namrud. After Namrud did everything,
including throwing Ibrahim in the fire. All of this didn't work. You know, finally what Namrud said? He said, leave Ibrahim alone. One thing I've learned from Ibrahim, whoever wants to worship the strongest God should find the Lord of Ibrahim.
I found, this is the enemy saying to Ibrahim, he said, I found the Lord of Ibrahim to be the strongest God ever.
Finally, Ibrahim, who they wanted to kill and burn, he was walking in the city freely, nobody can even touch him.
Not because he has an arms, or he has soldiers, but he has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another example, Musa alayhi salam. You know, Musa, Fir'aun wanted to kill him at some point. Musa even left the city and went to the city of Midian, where he lived there with Prophet Shu'aib, got married. And he still wanted in Egypt.
But finally he was able to come back to Egypt and walk freely and even become victorious upon his worst enemy, Pharaoh. And the reason is taqwa Allah.
So Imam Ali reminds us, he says, وَعَاشَ فِي بِلَادِ عَدُوِهِ
آمِنًا. That is one of the benefits of taqwa in this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to develop taqwa Allah, Ya Rabbi Alameen.
My dear brothers and sisters, our khutbah today is about how to come closer to Allah. How can we become closer to Allah? The reason is, as you know, in every ibadah we do, every ibadah, one of the main things is to get closer to Allah. That's why when we make salat, what do we say? Qurbatan ila Allahi ta'ala. When I want to give a sadaqah, qurbatan ila Allahi ta'ala. I want to help someone, qurbatan ila. Every action we do as a Muslims, the main purpose is qurbatan ila Allah.
How can a mu'min, a person, becomes one of the closest ones to Allah?
Before we go to that point, the ayah we read is in Surah Al-Waqa, ayah number 10 to ayah number 12, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ السَّابِقُونَ.
In this beginning of the Surah Al-Waqa, Allah talks about three different groups.
One, Ashab al-Maymana, Ashab al-Mash'ama, then there is As-Sabiqun.
Now, who are the first two groups? That is one story.
But we're talking about the third group, which is called As-Sabiqun. As-Sabiqun are known from the word As-Sibaq. As-Sibaq meaning the foremost people.
Now, what does it mean, foremost people?
Meaning people who always in the front line. What does it mean? Now, in tafsir, there are two tafsirs about this ayah. One, they said, As-Sabiqun is referring to the people who are or were the first people to accept religions. Those people are known to be four individuals. In the hadith of Adil Bayt alayhi salam, there are four people. From Adam up to Prophet Muhammad, there are four people are known to be as-sabiqoon. Who are they? Number one, they says Habil. Habil, the son of Prophet Adam alayhi salam, when Adam alayhi salam presented the religion that Allah wanted them to practice, Habil was the first one. Qabil rejected, and we know the story. So Habil was known as Awwalus Sabiqun, the first one to accept the religion of Allah coming from Prophet Adam alayhi salam. That's number one. Number two, they said As-Sabiqun, the second one, is known to be Mu'min Al Fir'aun. Mu'min Al Fir'aun, you know, is one of the men who were working in the government of Fir'aun. One of the higher positions too. But he was a believer, practicing his religion based on the teaching of Musa alayhi salam, without letting anybody to know his faith. In our aqidah is called taqiyya. He's hiding his faith in order to protect his life. So this, at the time of Musa alayhi salam, when Musa presented his religion, his calling to people to Allah, the first person to accept was Mu'min Ali Fir'aun. And his name came to Quran in many places. That is the second As-Sabiqun. The third As-Sabiqun is known as Habibun Najjar, one of the great men in the Islamic history as well. This man was known also to be a very, very dedicated, and was the first in line to accept the religion despite the difficulty of that time. And he's known as Habibun Najjar. That's number three. Number four, they say As-Sabiqun is Al-Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi wa sallam. As you know, historically, it is proven that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam presented Islam to the Ummah, the first one to accept was Amir al-Mu'mineen. Now today, if you look at the history, they divided, they said, among the children was Imam Ali, among the adults is the Abu Bakr, right? But even between the two, historically, Imam Ali was first before Abu Bakr. And he, Imam Ali, says, "Ana awwalul qawm Islam." I am the first one among the entire of you to accept Islam. That is Imam Ali. So they say these four people are called As-Sabiqun. That's one tafsir. But then there is tafsir called Tafsir Umumi, general. And he's saying it's not just these four are known Sabiqun. As-Sabiqun are the people who are in front line to do every good deeds. It's called As-Sabiqun. What does it mean? Meaning, if a call comes, there is a position or there is a good deed to do, they're always in front of mind. And let me give you a practical example. Number one, when they hear adhan, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, hayya ala salat, hayya ala al-falah, the first people to leave everything to run to the salat is called as-sabiqun. That's one of the practical examples of sabiqun. They leave everything and rush to go and do what? And do their salat on time. It's called as-sabiqun. That's number one. Number two, the meaning of as-sabiqun also, whenever there is a call of a good deed, a person is needy, or somebody is needy, we need support, we need help. Wherever they can help, they always in front line to have to make it happen. That person is called As-Sabiqun. That's number two. Number three, As-Sabiqun also can be whenever a person learns something new, good, they rush in putting it into practice.
is called As-Sabiqun. Because you know, sometimes we hear, we learn a lot of things, but we never practice it.
I come to a majlis, I hear something good. Ahlul Bayt teaches, you should do it as a mu'min. I hear it, yes, I walk out and I leave it right at the door. Now, As-Sabiqun, no, I hear good things and I try my best to put it into practice.
Whether be in akhlaq, I learn a good character. That Islam teaches, this akhlaq is a good thing. A mu'min should have this akhlaq.
I learn about it, I started to practice it.
It's also considered one of the sabiqun. Now, the reason why we explaining this, as-sabiqun, Allah said, people who always strive and try to be in front line of good deeds, Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ. Allah said, they are the ones who will be considered closest ones to Allah.
So, if I want to become مُقَرَّب إِلَى Allah, closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best thing to do is to do what? Is to make sure that I am in front line of striving. And by the way, we have to understand one important thing, brothers and sisters. When we say strive and doing things in the Islam, doesn't expect you to do beyond your capacity.
Whatever is your limitation, you do with it that line and it's accepted.
And not only is accepted,
that is what is expected from you as a mu'min. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رَبَّنَا لَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. Oh Allah, do not put the responsibility on us which we have no ability to do. Allah wouldn't do that.
So what is required from us is to do our ability. So here Quran says, when a person have this habit of striving and trying to do the to be the front line of doing the good things,
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they are the ones who are muqarrabun. And then Quran says, who are the muqarrabun? It's a fi jannatin na'im. Those are the ones who will be in Jannah tonight. Now, I don't want to go into ayahs in the Quran which talks about fada'il muqarrabun, but what I want to emphasize, what can one do to earn the level of muqarrabun?
Where do I start? Now here, there are five things Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam mentioned. One can do these five things to become among muqarrabun.
And by the way, when we talk about muqarrab, people who are close to Allah. And this is not a joke. Now today, if anybody tells you, anyone tells you and I, Sayyid Sistani wants to make you one of his closest people, how do you feel?
And Marja tells you, you know, because you have been selected to be one of the closest ones to Sayyid Sistani,
you feel honored, right? Because you're going to be one of the closest of the Marja. Now imagine if you are given the opportunity to be closer to Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The honor is even higher, huh? Now what if you are to be the closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
That is where the importance of this comes in. When Allah said, أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ, they are the closest one to Allah. Now what are those things that we can do to earn closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Here the first thing they said, hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma salli ala, that the first thing one can use to get closer to Allah is al-aql.
Al-aql? Yes.
How?
So I'm going to spend a minute.
But that is come from whom? From Rasulullah telling Imam Ali, where he says, Ya Ali, O Ali, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ يَتَقَرَّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَوْ إِلَى خَالِقِهِمْ بِالْبِرِّ فَتَقَرَّبْ إِلَيْهِ بِالْعَقْلِ.
Oh Ali, whenever time comes you see people, they are striving to get closer to Allah with good deeds only,
he says, you strive to get closer to Allah with your aql.
Why? The Rasulullah says, فَإِنَّ التَّقَرُّبَ إِلَى اللَّهِ بِالْأَقْلِ أَسْبَقُهُمْ.
The best of things that can bring you closer to Allah is to come to Allah through the aql. Now what does it mean? Number one, my brothers and sisters, you know, there is nothing in Islam, nothing in Islam that you can use to worship Allah better than to use your aql.
Aql meaning what?
What do you mean by aql?
We mean an aql is the power Allah gave every human being to know right and wrong, using that to know what is the best and do the best.
I'll give you an example. Today, if you and I go to the any store, Best Buy, you go to anyone, any store. You wanted to buy a laptop, you wanted to buy a phone. Which phone are you looking for? You're looking for the best quality. Alright?
Why best quality?
Because it lasts better.
It might be expensive, but your aql tells you the best thing to buy. Now I can buy this, which is like $30, $40 phone, versus let's say $1,000 phone. I know this was mine,
but I know the service and the lasting of this is more than this. That is what we call aql.
Whenever a mu'min wants to serve Allah,
let the aql play that big role. And when the aql plays that big role in your ibadah, it becomes the best way to get closer to Allah.
That's number one. Number two, the second thing one can come closer to Allah also is through al-ikhlas. Ikhlas means what?
You make your niyyah only and only for the pleasure of Allah in every act of ibadah.
Everything that you do. Before I start my salah, before I give sadaqah, before I do any good deeds, first and foremost, stop.
It's like when you get to four-way stop, right? You have to stop, look at the right, look at the left, look in front before you proceed.
Now, in ibadah as a Muslim, we are required that whenever the action comes, stop first.
And make sure that the niyyah of your action is only meant for Allah before you proceed. And my dear brothers and sisters, this niyyah and ikhlas is even better than the action itself.
The most important is ikhlas. That whatever you do, let it be for the pleasure of Allah. Now listen to the hadith Imam Ali says here. He says, تقرب العبد إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى بإخلاص أفضل التقرب إليه.
When a person purifies his intention or her intention in any action for the sake of Allah, that brings you closer to Allah. Now, it doesn't have to be many acts. One sincere act can bring you closer than ever.
But it requires that taqarrub ila Allah through ikhlas. That's number two. Number three, they say one of the things that also can bring a mu'min closer to Allah
is al-buka min khashyatillah. Crying for the fear of Allah between you and Allah. At night, at home, when there is nobody's watching. You remember sin I committed. I remember actions I'm not supposed to do and I did. And I regret about it. And I shed tears.
For that matter,
that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Listen to the hadith
from our Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam. Muhammad wa ali.
Where he says, كَانَ فِي مَا نَاجَ اللَّهُ نَبِيَّ اللَّهِ مُوسَى. One of the communication between Allah and Musa, when Musa went to Jabal al-Tur,
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him in Hadith al-Qudsi, يَا مُوسَى أَبْلِغْ قَوْمَكَ.
Oh Musa, tell your people. أَنَّهُ لَا يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ الْمُتَقَرِّبُونَ بِمِثْلِ He said, nobody can come closer to me. Allah is telling Musa, tell your people, if they want to become closer to me, Allah,
he said, the best of the things or the ways you can do that
is through al-buka min khashyati. Through crying for the fear of Allah. And this crying doesn't have to be a lot of tears. In some hadith, even if a drop of a tear, which is like a wing of a fly, is enough as long as it's for the fear of Allah. Then the hadith continue. وَمَا تَعَبَّدَ إِلَيَّ الْمُتَعَبِّدُونَ بِمِثْلِ الْوَرَعِ مِنْ خَشْيَتِ. Nothing also one can become closer to Allah and earn the closeness to Allah better than being one who cries from the sins or the bad actions that I commit. And we all have one too. We all have bad things. That if I can make a time at night between me and Allah and remember those and go through them and cry and ask Allah for forgiveness, this will earn you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is number three. Number four, one of the things that can bring you closer to Allah is taking your wajibat in port. And this is very important, brothers and sisters. You know, sometimes we don't know the priorities in Islam. Sometimes we have wajib and we have mustahab. You see a person, there is a mustahab, he or she leaves the mustahab, wajib, and busy doing mustahabat over and over and over while wajib is still pending. That's not how things work in Islam. Give me one practical example. Sometimes at night, people wake up for Salat al-Layl, and the time of Salat al-Layl has passed and it's almost time for Salat al-Fajr. Now, what do? They commit, they start up doing Salat al-Layl and Salat al-Layl and Salat al-Layl and Salat al-Layl. Fajr times comes and over and over and over, and they still busy with Salat al-Layl. Now, this is not how we're supposed to do it. Mustahabbat is good, but the wajib takes the priority over the mustahabbat. Yes, one can pray Salat al-Mustahabbat as long as mustahab doesn't override the time of wajib. If I wake up 30 minutes before Salat al-Fajr, I do my Salat al-Layl and then Fajr, yes, that's good. But if I wake up, it's time for Fajr, then I cannot leave Fajr and get busy with the Salat al-Layl. This is one of the things we have to know the priority. Now, sometimes people say, no, I'm not going to pay my khums, but I'm going to give sadaqah. Now, sadaqah is mustahab. Al-khums is wajib. No, I'm not going to pay. I'm going to give sadaqah. No, you're not doing the right thing. Because giving sadaqah is mustahab. Paying your khums is wajib. Now, another thing people do mistake. They say, oh, I'm not going to go to hajj. I'm going to go to ziyarah. Now, ziyarah is mustahab. Hajj is wajib. Now, we have to understand when is which one is which, and when which one can take their turn. Now, listen to the hadith al-Qudsi about knowing al-wajib and mustahab. The Prophet tells us, he said, in Salat, in the night of Isra and Mi'raj, he said, when I went to Isra and Mi'raj, Allah spoke to me. And what did he say? قال تعالى يا محمد ما تقرب إلي عبدي بشيء أحب إلي مما افترضت عليه. Oh Muhammad, none of my servants can come closer to me with an act which makes me more happier than to do something I made it wajib upon him, and he did exactly that. Wajibat comes first. A mu'min, I supposed to know which one is mustahab, which one is wajib. And I need to make sure that my wajibat is taken care of first. Then I can go to mustahab. But I cannot ignore the wajib and rush to mustahab. is one of the things that brings you close to Allah. Now the last not the least. The Prophet says, there is nothing you can bring you closer to Allah than tawadu. Being humble. Being down to earth. When a person is arrogant into themselves, they cannot be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, one of the things that led Shaitan to become Shaitan was what? It was the arrogance. He was close to Allah. But the moment he did this arrogance, what happened? He lost everything. One of the things that can bring a mu'min close to Allah is what we call at-tawadu. Being down to earth with other people who are your surrounding. Down to earth with your wife. Down to earth with your husband. Being humble to your neighbors. Humble to your relatives. Humble to your surroundings. This can bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith says, from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, فِيمَا أَوْحَى اللَّهُ إِلَى دَاوُدِ. One of the things that Allah revealed to Dawood alayhi salam, that Allah said to him, يَا دَاوُد كَمَا أَنَّ أَقْرَبُ النَّاسِ إِلَيَّ مِنَ اللَّهِ الْمُتَوَاضِعُونَ. He said, get to know, يَا دَاوُد, that the closest ones to me are the people who are down to earth, who are humble. You know, a lot of times when we get money or position or power, that is when the arrogance starts to come in. And this can put you very far away from Allah. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to do so, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you, help us to practice these teachings, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Help us to become closer to you, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna atainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. اللهم صل على بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة على المصطفى وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما آخرهم قائمهم قائم أهل بيت محمد المهدي المنتظر روحي وأرواح العالمين لتربة مقدمه الفداء اللهم بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرأ إلى قيام يوم الدين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. My dear brothers and sisters, one of the reasons we are talking about this khutbah is because, as we know, we just started a new year. Like 2 weeks ago, we started this new year. And in the new year, many of us have new resolutions. What I want to do? This 2022, I wanted to have a better job. I want to lose a weight. I want to travel. I want to do this. I want to do this. So many things in the list. Now, one of the things that I want to present to myself and to all of us, that one can make one of my resolutions for this year, is to be among the muqarrabun ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That in this 2022, I want to do what it takes to become closer to Allah. You know, we have been very close to Shaitan too long. We have been friends of Shaitan for so long. But this year, I want to change and make myself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we can make this as a year resolution and follow these teachings the whole year, you can be successful. And this should be one of our yearly resolutions. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we all strive in this good course, Ya Rabbal Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us in this great course, Ya Rabbal Alameen. The last, not the least, my dear brothers and sisters, is what is happening in Saudi Arabia. There is so much that's going on. and it's heartbreaking. But the saddest part, when the Muslim world are quiet about it. That is the hardest part. Now, if the mu'mineen, the Muslims around the globe, if they will do something about it, that will be at least calming people down. Now, one, there is so many changes is happening in Saudi Arabia. With this new bin Salman, there is so much is happening. Now, number one, which is the saddest of all, so much execution and killing of young sheikhs. So many youth are being killed, hanged, for simple reasons. And the ummah are watching and they're seeing this and nobody says anything. That is number one. Number two, one of the saddest things also that is happening is so many changes of rule. And I'm sure some of you have seen in the news before the new year what they have done of inviting musicians around the globe to come and have a good time in Saudi Arabia. This is the land of Muslims, where the Qibla of Muslims are. How in the world this is happening? In that land. And the Ummah are hearing, they're seeing, and they're quiet. Now we all have responsibilities. We all have responsibilities in front of Allah. That we will be questioned when something like this is happening. What did you do? What did you say? We have to do something, brothers and sisters. And we all should do in our own capacity to at least put the awareness out there of what is happening. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help our ummah, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you day in and day out, help us to know our religion and be more religious, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, show us the right way and help us to stay on the right way, ya Rabbal Alameen. Show us the wrong way and help us to stay away from it, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, help us to be what you want us to be, rather than being what we want to be, ya Rabbal Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, inna atainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.